Anyway, first of all, my grateful and loving pranams to my dear Swami and to my Sai Ram, to all my Sai family. This is in the year 1992. We were living in Saket in New Delhi, and we were part of the Malviya Nagar Samiti. And every day was full of Sai activities. Lots of bhajans, lots of study circles, seva in various fields. So we were really very, very busy. And so much of seva was there. But then I always thought of that as just helping out somebody. I'm not particularly the parthi seva. It was just an ordinary seva. And then came the parthi yatra. So everybody went to Prashanti Seva. My husband and my daughter were both Sevadals, and they both were regularly going to Prashanti. So they went in 91, and then they came back with a lot of, experiences, how Swami gave them Padaramskar and what fun it was and all that. And I couldn't go because I had commitments. My son was in school. My father and brother were living with me. So I had domestic commitments, so I couldn't go for the seva. And then next year again they went for seva, and I was back at home. And then this got me a bit, my green-eyed monster popped up and said, so, and complained to Swami, what is this? You're not letting me come for the seva, and I'm not going to get Pada Namaskar. This is not fair. And kept on complaining to him. And then a couple of days later, I got a dream. And in that, Swami comes to my house. He's sitting on the sofa and he calls out to me. So I go there and say, Swami, you're here. So he says, what can I do? You've been complaining so much that you can't come for Prati Seva. You can't get Pada Namaskar. So I thought I should come. And then he said, do you think that the Seva that you are doing here is any less than the Prashanti Seva? Certainly not, he says. Every Seva that you do is Parthi Seva, and every Seva that you do reaches me. But I said, Swami, what about the Pada Namaskar? I'm not getting that. So he says, why do you think I've come here today to give you Pada Namaskar? So come on, take Pada Namaskar, he said. And there I went flat on his feet, and it was wonderful. He said, come on, hold your hand. And I held my hand like a cup, and he poured kumkum and materialized jasmine flowers and filled my hand with those things. The next morning when I got up, now the dream was so fresh in my mind, I was literally on cloud nine. And I said, oh, Swami has given me Pada Namaskar. Now I must do seva with even more vigor, do more seva and more conscientiously, and try and sort of get his blessings all the time. So it was a wonderful period. And Swami never let me come to Prashanti Seva many times. In fact, in all these 30 odd years, I've probably been 4 times for Prashanti Seva. But wherever I have been, whichever city I have been, whether it's in Delhi or Mumbai or Botswana in Africa, we were there for 10 years. He gave me so many opportunities to do seva that I was, very satisfied with that. And I always thought that wherever I do seva, that is Prashanti Nilayam. And whatever seva I do, that is Parthi Seva. I'm reminded of another incident where Swami always says that, see me in every being. Everything is me. I'm the one who is in each and every part of the universe. But you don't recognize me when I come in different forms. And we have read in Tapovan and Satcharitra how Shirdi Baba promised to come for an Udyapan ceremony. And he goes there with two other people, but the host does not recognize him. And then he says, Swami says, Shirdi Baba says, I came to your house as I promised, but you didn't recognize me. What can I do for that? Just an incident like this happened in my life. I'd like to share this experience with you all. In 1993, that was, we were still living in Saket, Delhi. It was, I think, November of 1993. My mother-in-law, who used to live in Bombay, she had a mild heart attack. And I rushed to Bombay, and the doctor said it's a mild attack, but since she's frail and, you know, getting older, she should not be staying alone. She was living alone in Bombay. So you better take her with you wherever you stay. So I said, fine, as soon as she got, you know, she was better and fit to travel. So we brought her to Delhi. Slowly, with medication and Swami's immense grace, she recovered. And she was, you know, she was not very active, but she was walking around, doing her own job, attending bhajans once in a way, and she was okay. She was doing well. For the next 7-8 months, she was absolutely fine. And one, sometime in the month of August, there was a little setback, and she became very sick, and her condition became bad. She couldn't breathe properly, and she couldn't eat and drink anything, and barely lift her head up and sit down. So it was a bit very, very worrying. And the doctor came and gave her some, you know, injections, medication. And he says, let's watch for a few days, and then we'll admit her to the hospital and, you know, give her the insulin, saline and stuff like that. So he said, okay. And then we said, Swami, we are very worried. It's up to you now what you do. We can try and help us to get, you know, get her better. And so we just prayed to him. Next morning, there was a knock on the door. And as I opened the door, I found an old man there with a dhoti kurta and a, you know, this Maharashtrian topi on his head. And he wanted some food. He just kept doing this. He didn't speak anything. So I said, okay, you sit down. Come inside and sit down. So he said, there was a little ledge outside. He sat down there. I went and made some tea and biscuits and something. I gave him some fruits and all that. And he ate all that. And as he was leaving, I said, you come and have lunch in the afternoon. So he nodded his head and went away. And promptly at around 12:30, 1 o'clock, he came back. So I served him some hot food. He had the food and, you know, I was very happy that I could, you know, he had the food. So I told him, you come again in the evening to have food. So then he came back again. Now, every day this continued. He came in the morning and the evening. He would eat properly and go back. And this continued for about 7-8 days. The meanwhile, Amma, who was not having any food. In fact, I used to hold her in my lap and feed her like a baby, you know, with a little spoon. She was taking just that much nutrition. Slowly, she regained her strength. She got up from bed and she could sit up and eat. You know, I could feed her properly instead of lying on my lap. And so we were very happy. We said, thank you, Swami. She's regained her strength, although she's had no food to eat at all. But then once she got better, that Babaji stopped coming home. So I said, oh my God, what happened? He didn't turn up this morning. He didn't turn up in the evening. So I got worried. I said, oh my God, I hope he's not sick or, you know, something's happened to him. So I went around the colony asking the, you know, telewala and the presswala and said, have you seen this Baba? Have you seen this Baba? They said, what Baba are you talking about? There's nobody like us in this colony. So I said, oh, I was very, very disappointed. I came home and then it struck me that, oh my God, Amma's getting better was directly related to that old Baba coming and having food in my house. Swami had partaken of the food and given her all the strength to get up and, you know, recover from her deteriorating condition. So I said, oh God, the miracle, this is a miracle just in front of my eyes. And I was chiding myself for not, you know, realizing that that was Shirdi Baba himself. I never thought much about it at that time. But then I knew that Shirdi Baba had come. He had taken food, and I was thrilled and blessed and so grateful for him, for giving me that opportunity to serve him. It was a wonderful, wonderful feeling. Then Amma got better, and then she wasn't doing too well. So in a couple of months, in October, she passed away. And you could see Swami's, you know, drama in this as well. My husband was supposed to leave that day for Bangalore on official work. And he said, I'll go and see Swami in Parthi or wherever he is in Bangalore and get some vibhuti and all that. So just before leaving, the taxi was waiting outside. He went into the bedroom and said, Amma, I'm going to Bangalore. I'll go and have Baba's darshan. I'll bring vibhuti for you. And then he just hugged her goodbye. And she just looked at him and flopped on his chest and took her last breath. It was such a peaceful and glorious end to her wonderful life. And Swami helped both mother and son to be together at that last moment. I mean, it was, can you imagine if he had already left for the airport? There was no cell phone those days. He couldn't have contacted him or anything like that. It would have been very difficult. But Swami, in his grace and his blessing and his love, he just took care of every single thing. So why should we worry when he's always with us, always helping us? You only have to ask, and you don't have to plead also. You just have to ask him with lots of love in your heart, and he comes there to help you. So each time when I see someone who comes in the house, comes and knocks on the door, I always think, oh, this is Swami coming. Let me treat him as such. So this was one wonderful experience that I wanted to share with all of you. And thank you very much for letting me do that. And Sai Ram.